And now we have some time for questions. Who has a question? There must be some here. Yes.
We heard mention of calls for President Obama to release the full report and for Dianne Feinstein to release the report. Am I correct in assuming that both have the power to release or read into the Federal Register the report? And are there others who also have the power or authority to release the report?
To restate the question for the video here, the gist is that this demand and the petition is for Dianne Feinstein and or the President Obama to release the full report. Are there others who also would have that capacity? Who'd like to respond to that?
Yes,
John Kariakou. John,
to the
mic here.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. Yes. The President, of course, has ultimate declassification authority. He can declassify the entire report with the stroke of a pen. But any member of the Senate Intelligence Committee can insert the report into the congressional record, also in its entirety, and not face any legal consequences. They can make it an official congressional record and just release it to the American people. All they have to do is to schedule a hearing, either of the committee or of one of the committee's subcommittees, and say that they want to insert this as an official document in the congressional record. Unfortunately, so far, and the report's been out for quite some time, no one has had the guts to do that.
Other questions? Yes.
It's not clear to me, is this report just about Guantanamo, or does it cover a range of other activities?
Question is whether this full report covers only Guantanamo or another range of activities. Who'd like to address that? Okay. David Swanson.
Well, John may want to speak to this too, but I believe it covers far beyond just Guantanamo. It covers torture at a number of so-called black sites and in Iraq and other locations in Afghanistan. And you can, in fact, read a 500-page summary of the 7,000-page report, 500 pages with lots of blacked-out stuff on it. But what we're asking for is the full 7,000-page report, which is described by Senator Feinstein as a completely different thing from the 500-page summary, and an overwhelming case that torture doesn't work on its own terms, which an incredible percentage of Americans have been persuaded in recent years by government propaganda and Hollywood films, Hollywood / CIA films, et cetera, that it does. But it's certainly not just Guantanamo, but Guantanamo is a case where the CIA had a separate building where it took people and where it tortured them to death in some cases, and brought back bodies and pretended they'd hung themselves. And that is not what you see in the Hollywood CIA movies or television shows like 24. And if we're going to talk about torture and have debates about torture and have presidential candidates make campaign promises to torture, we ought to have a basic understanding of what we're talking about. And this report would have the authority and the weight to garner that sort of attention and persuade people of what those who've already looked into it already know, which is that beyond being illegal and immoral, it's counterproductive. It generates enemies and it doesn't work.
Just one other little question. Would it include the practice of transferring prisoners from U.S. jurisdiction to a foreign jurisdiction with the expectation that they would be tortured when they got there?
Well, that...
What was the word? Rendition, I think.
Rendition. Yeah. John may want to add to this. I do not know. I think it is focused primarily on torture by U.S. Staff. But yes, well, that's gone on for decades and has continued since the Nobel laureate moved into the White House. And this is the problem when you announce that you're ending torture. You announce that you're banning something that was a crime and thereby pretend it wasn't a crime. and forbid prosecution of it. It continues. And so we all talk about torture in the past tense and torture being brought back by Donald Trump. But torture has moved in the direction of being outsourced during the past 8 years. And that's nothing new.
But this report includes rendition?
I do not know.
I don't think any of us really know if it includes rendition. I would assume that it does, because the whole purpose of the report was to be the A to Z history of the CIA's torture program. You can't write that history without an accounting of rendition and what's called extraordinary rendition. There are legal scholars who will argue, and who have argued, that there's nothing illegal about rendition. If you are an Egyptian and you've been found in Al-Qaeda safe house in Pakistan, the Pakistanis don't want you. They ask the United States to send you back to Egypt. You're an Egyptian. There's nowhere else that you can go. However, if you are an Egyptian who's caught in an Al-Qaeda safe house in Pakistan and you're sent to Syria or Morocco or Algeria for some softening up, and then we'll see what you say in an interrogation afterward, that's clearly illegal. That's kidnapping, and it's a violation of any number of both U.S. and international laws. I personally believe that a full accounting of extraordinary rendition is contained in the torture report. I don't have any proof. That's just my gut. But I think that it's probably a prominent issue that's raised.
Are there any other questions? Okay. Yes.
The sort of cavalier comments, hi John.
Hi.
Do you feel that they're even grounded in any kind of, accurate assessment or from the intelligence community, or are they just sort of reactionary, sort of flipping to maybe speaking to his base, or like, what was your response to them?
And just to summarize a question for the video, given the cavalier comments by the incoming president about torture, can we assess what the basis of that is in terms of any official reports? I think that's the gist of the question.
I think what we've heard so far from President-elect Trump is indicative of the ignorant, uninformed, misinformed president that we should expect in the next 4 years. It's my understanding that the president-elect has only been briefed a handful of times. Those briefings have not included the torture program. And I think that he is reacting to his own ill-informed gut, his own preconceived notion of what the torture report, or I'm sorry, what the torture program was supposed to have accomplished. He doesn't know any better. I hope that he's smart enough to realize that he's been wrong. I doubt that he is. And I don't think that especially John Brennan's CIA has urged Donald Trump to reinstitute this program. You know, John Brennan, for all his faults, and despite the fact that he lied to the American people about not having known anything about the torture program, at least has come out to say that it was wrong, it was a mistake, and it ought not be repeated. So I can't imagine that that same John Brennan would be urging the president-elect, or would allow his analysts to urge the president-elect to reinstitute the program.
And just quickly, if they do reinstitute the program, what kind of international backlash might there be? How would that affect the United States' credibility, for example?
I think that it would be very damaging to American credibility abroad. You know, so much of this program has already been made public. At least the skeleton of the program has already been made public. most countries of the world don't want to have anything to do with this program. So where in 2002, we may have been able to pull a prime minister aside and say, listen, you have a base in the south of your country. There's a building on that base, and we really want to use it, and we don't want anybody to know we're using it. Where that may have worked in 2002, it's not going to work in 2017. The cat's out of the bag, and people don't want to be associated with this program. The only country in the world that is even considering bringing back torture is the United States. That has to stop now. So no, I think this is very much a Donald Trump thing. It's not the CIA pushing it on Donald Trump.
Just not to disagree, but just to add, I think that Donald Trump is also looking at U.S. public opinion. And if the U.S. public were overwhelmingly demanding an end to torture and overwhelmingly understood what Dianne Feinstein says this report shows, that torture does not work, if the U.S. public had not seen Zero Dark 30 and similar pieces of disinformation, Donald Trump would be impacted by that. And so releasing this report is not primarily because I think Donald Trump will read anything 7,000 pages long, but because I think it would impact the media and the public and public opinion and what it's possible to put into Hollywood movies. And that would in turn impact Donald Trump. There is some hope of that. But I think, you know, when the prosecutors in Spain were looking seriously at prosecuting U.S. officials for torture because the U.S. was not doing it, and people in the United States, including through a Roots Action campaign, were telling Spanish prosecutors, yes, go ahead. You know, that was stopped by the Spanish government, but there is going to be a vastly increased interest in such prosecutions by international bodies and by foreign courts under universal jurisdiction with Donald Trump. The world does not love and respect him enough to dissuade the momentum that's going to build for prosecutions elsewhere.
Are there any other questions? Yes.
Can you explain that stack of papers?
Right there? Maybe I'll ask David to explain this stack of paper, which is the petition, and also what might become of it later this week. David Swanson.
This is a printout of names, towns, states, and comments. Around 60,000 people have signed this petition, and a good percentage have added comments, and some of them are quite eloquent and informative, and you can find all of this on the website. It's right at the top of rootsaction.org at the moment, or you can come take a look at this, but we are planning to hand this, if possible, to Senator Feinstein tomorrow, and again, ask her, as we are asking President Obama, to go ahead and make it public, which, as we heard from John, either of them could do. But there are people in other agencies and staff people who worked on the report who almost certainly could do so as well if they had the nerve and the decency. And we strongly encourage someone to be that hero and make that thing public. And we will appreciate them very, very much for doing so.
Okay, any last question here? Yes.
What do you think the most effective things are that the American people who are appalled by torture could be doing in their communities to raise this awareness?
The most effective things that people in the United States could do to have this awareness. Any comments from speakers?
Yeah, I mean, from a citizen perspective, this has been a tricky issue. I think it's incredibly disturbing for Americans to confront, you know, this ugly reality. And then there's a massive mechanism of psychological and political and moral denial. And then cutting through that has always been an extraordinary challenge. And then we and other public advocates have tried everything in the democratic toolbox, petitions, marches, civil disobedience, calls to Congress, letters to Congress, you know, all but lighting our hair on fire. And then, as David said, arguably the country remains pro-torture. It's certainly pro-Guantanamo, according to public polling. And people in favor of keeping it open, that number has increased since Obama stepped into office. So, bizarrely, there's still, you know, the absence of an accurate understanding of just what happened. So the challenge is a sustained campaign of public education, you know, events like this, you know, local action by people talking to neighbors and friends, schools, churches, synagogues, mosques, and then trying incrementally to build some consensus in the national memory. You're never going to get everybody that something horrible happened. And then the hope is that one day this is looked at like the internment of Japanese during World War II, or Indian removal, or Native American removal, or slavery, you know, and it's sort of morally stained. And then I've been working on this issue for 10 years, you know, trying to shut down what's become one of the most notorious prisons in the history of the world. It's quite profound when you think about it. Devil's Island, the Bastille, Auschwitz. It's not Auschwitz, but it's pretty terrible. You know, this will be in textbooks 100 years from now if the planet's around. You know, and then we'll be able to say that when an extraordinary moral challenge was posed, like we stood up and do the right thing, like some at greater risk, you know, than others. So it's important to do for the soul of the individual. It's important to take on as a national project. And I wish there were like an easy fix to the problem of denial and the kind of ignorance that Mr. Trump displays. But we won't let this go because it, you know, can't be, you know, let go of. It's, you know, too important. And I should say that there's a demonstration tomorrow at the Supreme Court at 11:30, followed by some form of public action at the Senate buildings where three Trump appointees are being, you know, vetted for confirmation. And then today was announced that, you know, over 100 retired generals and senior intelligence officials had sent a private letter to Trump urging that he not dust off the torture program. That kind of thing helps. And then oddly, you know, the national security establishment has taken some of the most forceful and principal positions on this. Not everybody, but, you know, some folks, and then that counts for a lot. So all levers of power in our democracy need to be pushed and yanked on. Thank you.
There are people deeply offended that the Clintons are going to celebrate with Donald Trump at his inauguration. What do they make of Barack Obama protecting Dick Cheney's legacy? What do they make of keeping out of public sight the work of someone like Dick Cheney, who is considered a respectable, non-criminal, free citizen coming in to advise the Trump administration on how to take the gloves off? Because we haven't gotten beyond that. I would say call the White House with that demand right now. Call Senator Feinstein's office. Call Donald Trump. Tell him to announce that he's going to make it public if they don't. And once he's president, if that happens, I still hope not, call him and tell him to make it public immediately. But go to your city council and get a resolution that says we want this made public and we want prosecution locally. Go to your state legislatures. We want prosecution of torture if it's within our jurisdiction. Sign this petition at rootsaction.org. Write letters to the editor. Call radio shows. Do all the activist things. Build momentum for this. And the deadline of just having, you know, less than 2 weeks to do it may help get people energized on the phones, on the emails, and making it news in the local news. And you never know.
So to look a little bit beyond the next 10 days, actually, I think the most effective thing that a lot of activists can do to fight the Trump agenda writ large is local action and ensuring that local police and local lawmakers are not complicit in pursuing the Trump agenda. What's been happening in North Carolina for probably about a decade, when local activists found out that a local airplane company was helping with the extraordinary rendition flights, they've been protesting at that airfield. They've been doing all sorts of local activities. And in Chicago, which has the unique distinction of police, a long history of police torture against citizens, has created a torture-free zone in Chicago. So there's a lot of tools that activists can use locally that can push back against things that we fear that the Trump administration is going to pursue. And if, correct me if I'm wrong, John, but even after January 21st, any member of the Senate Intelligence Committee can still read the mm-hmm. torture report and put it into the record. So so the fight will continue.
Before we close, are there any more comments from any of the speakers? Okay. Well, I'd like to thank everyone for being here and look forward to working with you in the future.